7:30, and this meeting of the RMLD Board of Commissioners is being videotaped at the RMLD office at 230 Ash Street for distribution to the community TV stations in Reading, North Reading, Wilmington, and Linfield. The board recognizes the importance of hearing public comment at the discretion of the chair on items on and off the agenda, and we ask that all questions be directed to the chair and that you provide your name and address. I think with that, we could begin the meeting. Tom, are you okay to be the board secretary tonight?
Absolutely.
Okay.
You're doing everything tonight, Tom.
And we don't have FinCom here, but if they show up, we will gladly welcome them. I think we have a new employee of RMLD in the house, Janet Walsh.
Hi, Janet.
Did I get that right? Yep. The new HR director.
Welcome, Janet.
Welcome. Nice to meet you.
Nice to see you.
And Jason.
There's a lot of HR spirit on the board of commissioners.
Yeah. Maybe a little heavy.
It is never enough.
And with that, is there any public comment? I don't think we have any non-employees or board members in the house, correct? Okay. Liaisons, we don't have any of those. Well, Jason, is there anything you'd like to add from the CAB?
All set, thank you.
Okay. And with that, I think we're ready for the general manager's report.
Hey, thank you. Good evening. Just providing that we'll have a meeting, or we have scheduled meeting on December 2nd to present for Energy New England to present on the town of Reading payment. The May 2018 study that I did, where I had made recommendations, that's actually posted on the website under Board of Commissioners. It provides a lot of history. If you want to go back and read through that, I think it will help aid in you know, keeping up with the with that issue.
So I think we're all set with this meeting, right? It's at 6:30 on Monday the 2nd, correct? And John from Energy New England will be present. Is that right?
Correct.
Okay. And I think we're all set. There was an initial draft sent around, and I'm fine with it. If anybody else has comments, if not, are we okay to have Colleen share it out next week with...
was it sent around? I don't know.
Yeah, just for any... You know, our time is very tight on this. And
she received it. She received it. Yeah, everybody got it.
When was it sent?
I think Monday. I think it's a courtesy. I think it, you know, these reports are developed by staff and under Colleen's direction. So just like to get it out, you know, to sort of be able to post the meeting on Tuesday.
I can resend it, but my computer's down today, so
I thought I was.
Do you want to send it as draft, you mean, or do you want to?
We certainly can. I did, my one thought would be that we have this meeting scheduled, and we've been talking about this for months. And so, sure, if there's tweaks, but otherwise.
I'm sure there'll be tweaks. So I would not send it out as a fait accompli.
Okay.
Right. Send it as a draft.
Send it. Where would you send it?
I mean, if that it's available, if people want to see it, it's a draft.
Yeah,
I mean, next week, the
big
holiday.
Draft.
Yeah, next week's the holiday. We can't be initiating a big editing, you know, with five editors.
That was my comment. Comment is really, we've just gotten it.
Yep.
It deserves us to spend some time walking through it with the consultant who did it.
Yep.
And make sure we understand every aspect of it. And there will always be changes.
There always will be.
So let's just stamp a draft and be careful.
Okay.
At this point, I haven't even had a chance to read it.
I've only skimmed it myself. And yet next week's Thanksgiving with the meetings on Monday. So as a practical matter, it's a draft. And it's been a long time coming, so we'll share it out as a draft with that caveat, I think, is what the feedback.
Share it out as a draft to who?
It's to the public. I mean, if the interested members of the public want to see it, it's a stamp it draft and say, you know, something.
Yeah, I do have it. I have not gone through it, though.
Okay, so am I waiting to hear back from individual commissioners as if they have any additional information they'd want added to it before I don't know who you would like me to send it to. I could consider putting it on the website.
That's what Dan was talking about.
Put it on the website.
So people can call it up and it'll be right next to the one I did.
Yeah, that's fine.
I like that.
I guess my only two cents is if no one has had the chance to go through it completely. I'd just be concerned, you know, that no one's gone through it. It's been posted on the website. So,
well, that's why we stamp draft on every page.
No, but even, I mean, if you get something that's, you know, if it was all in Chinese and it said draft, I'd still feel uncomfortable about
understand.
It. You know what I'm saying, Dave? So
I understand what you're saying.
I would.
Well, if we need to do a motion to do the direction, but I think I've heard the sense of the board, three or four of us, that it's okay to post it with stamping a draft.
Yeah, I have no problem with that. I mean, it's going to become a public document at some point in time. So
yeah, I only, I'm sorry, go ahead.
So if members of the public have any comments on it as well, then, you know, we're sort of sharing it with them as well. And I don't mind getting, we should get that feedback.
Yeah, it's just research, it's not policy,
yeah.
Right? So
right. No, so we all have a different lens. So here's my lens that I look at it through. So I haven't seen it, so I may have no questions. I may have some additions, but that's okay.
Yep.
But, or I may disagree with the point. That's okay. But it may, if it's not understandable and it's gobbledygook, I think that's sort of, to me, that's where the drawing line is. And I'm not saying it is. I just, I have to be honest. It was a busy week for me. I missed it. So if nobody's seen it, I would just pause and say, should somebody see it? I'm happy to rely on
I think a number of us have skimmed it.
Yeah.
And I've skimmed it, but there's no conclusions really drawn in it.
Right.
So
it's not like it's right.
It's
well, do you want to delay it a day for Tom to read it? I mean,
no,
Tom.
I just raise that. So I'm happy to, if people feel, you know, that's, you know, basically directionally, you know, reasonable, which is all I'm saying. Because what I don't like is, because if it's not in that, it's not a theoretical issue for me. It's if it. As much as we're talking about the right of the public to see, which I'm 100% in agreement with, I think the presumption when the public reads it is that it's had some vetting, you know, that they're not...
But it has had vetting. It was vetted by staff and by Colleen and
so
Energy New England.
Yeah.
So, I mean,
okay.
Like many other reports that come out of the department.
Could we stamp it, draft, gobbledygook?
Sure.
Potentially some gobbledygook.
Yeah, I don't think it's gobbledygook. It presents a lot of good data.
I mean,
it doesn't come out saying what a number should be. It provides perspective. It provides comparisons, and makes some sort of formulaic recommendations. And those are good inputs. And
I'm fine with. I guess going forward, what is just a suggestion. I would say if we want to, this is a standing process. I would say submit it for review. Put a dead date when we'd like it to be looked at, so the board is noticed. Maybe it had it because I haven't looked at it, but or make that clear, and then I think that's a good process.
Agreed.
But on that, I'm fine.
Okay. Are we all clear?
We're good.
Okay.
Yep.
I'm
fine.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. All right. Now we have minutes. Yay! Thank you, Tracy, for doing the minutes. We have three sets of minutes. Should we take them one at a time, or
whatever you want to do? I think with minutes, we probably could do them all together.
Right. Is there any objection for anybody?
Mm-hmm. No real objections. I did notice that on the solar one, there was a lot of long discussion on the solar, which was great. The one line where there was a presentation made within the presentation, nothing was said about what the content of the guy's presentation was. What's that? I mean, maybe, just to acknowledge that the guy said some stuff. A lot of other people's comments were printed, just even if it's two sentences of what his points were. I would recommend adding that. And with that proviso, I'm ready to approve it, unless that needs to wait till the second.
Did the board approve the meeting minutes of May 7th, 2019, May 23rd, 2019,
but not
and June 20th, 2019, as corrected.
As corrected with the addition of, okay, fine. That's
second.
Recommendation, gentlemen.
Second.
All in favor? Okay. All right. 5-0. Thank you.
Chairman, can I make a comment about
please
the minutes?
So.
After all these years, in all my years, we've gone long minutes, we've gone short minutes, we've gone long. The idea of the minutes is just to summarize really what took place.
Yep.
It's not to quote people.
Okay.
You know, I've written minutes that says, comes through, you know, motion made. Then the next line is discussion ensued.
Yep, right.
And we can always go to the Bob Soley method. If somebody feels that in the method, if the minutes are that important, they want their quotes in, they they can add them in at the time that the motion is made.
So why don't you bring in on the next meeting some examples of the old and the new?
I don't have any of the old.
I don't disagree with you.
Any of the old, to be
the custom that we've been doing is...
I don't keep them.
What are you saying what you've read recently is too detailed?
Too detailed.
But it's not like
the,
this
it's
for...
Not the purpose. The minutes are not supposed to be a transcript.
Correct.
By law, that's not required.
Correct.
And,
okay.
And if someone really wants the intimate detail, they can go to the video.
Correct. They can
watch it.
Yeah,
or they can. You know, if somebody wants, feels that it's important that the quote gets in.
Yep. Right.
They can move to amend when we sit with the minutes here.
True.
Yeah.
Offline, it may. The problem is you don't want to. It's hard for some. I don't know if it's being critical, but for Tracy, it's really a case of knowing what constitutes reasonable amount, because if you do it once over lightly and then someone the board says, well, gee, you didn't capture this and this and this, well, I thought you did, you know what I mean? So,
but then you can add it in, Tom.
Right.
How do we give direction?
You want to make sure the minutes don't go to minute, you know?
Well, we don't want to get to this by, you know, having 10 sessions where we say, well, this is good, but now you're this way too many. So I think a simple idea would be to be a little more specific. Here's the pieces that, you know, action items, motions, you know, other things, but, you know, so Tracy has at least some guidance.
Okay, should we render this into a motion and give direction on this, or are we just giving direction and we only want to?
I don't think it requires a motion. Okay. We all understand that if we want to put in or make changes, which Phil has done many times, he has added certain things, we all understand that that's within our purview.
Okay, so the sense is we want to have the cliff notes, the tight ones.
Since I brought the ice, I'll write something up for the board.
Fine.
Can be reviewed.
Okay.
Excuse me, Colleen, is there anything that would concern you? Because, I mean, I don't know if there's another...
Actually, the law is quite minimal.
Yeah.
But I think that we want to be able to read the minutes and understand what was discussed, be able to go back in history, understand what was presented, and we can do that, and Tracy is more than qualified encapsulating that. And we've always in the past, if someone says, I'd like it to go on record this, we will provide that quote from that person. That's fine. And I think instead of Tracy spending, you know, 30 hours a week doing a word-for-word transcript, I think it's a much better use of her time in order to fall more tightly
to the law. Yeah, I think we all agree with that.
Yes.
Yeah, at your discretion, Colleen, I agree with you. So to implement the spirit of what you just said.
I'd like my quotes from this discussion verbatim.
This whole every soul will better be in those minutes.
Hey, you haven't said anything.
Okay, let's move on. We got big things to do.
Budget. The final, just a capstone comment.
No capstone.
If someone...
Okay, fine. Give me the capstone.
If someone isn't here, I think that needs to be also factored in the minutes, right? If you're not here at all for the meeting. In terms of, it doesn't change what we've said, it's just remembering that, you know,
that somebody wasn't...
There's no context for that person. Right?
Okay. That person can get the video and see the video if it's that important. I mean, I've missed meetings and basically watched the video of the meeting on RCTV.
You have it.
Idiots.
Yes. Yes, I am.
Okay, so let's move on. Colleen will implement per her lights and her discretion. All right, so Hamid, do you want to present the capital budget?
Well, sure, I'd be glad to.
Thank you.
Good evening. I'm going to present to CY 2020 budget to the board, and I'm going to present it in the same format that it was presented to CAB. This is going to be round two for Jason.
He looks excited to hear it again.
Okay. First, I'm going to go over the variances between the CY 19 budget and CY 19 estimates, why those variances exist. And then I'm going to move on to what we're proposing for CY 20, what's planned. Okay. Item numbers 2, 10, 28, 38, and 49. These are the ones that, you know, basically you see big variances, and I'm going to go through explaining why we have such big variances. So I'm going to start with item number 2, that's building upgrades. The reason that, you know, it went up from 125 to 395, basically the two big ticket items that caused it to go over are $150,000 deck that, you know, we're building right in back in the cafeteria, and also $185,000 generator that we didn't expect that to fail. It failed, and now we had to go out and you guys approved the bid so we can replace that. So basically, that's the reason for that. next item is item number 10. And you'll see that, you know, we went from 436, what was proposed or what was approved in budget CY19 to 765. The reason for that going up was that the three pad mount switchgear carried over from FY18 and five new pad mount switchgears received in CY2019. And plus the installation cost for five switches. That's what that basically was carried over. And the manufacturer did not send us the switches in time. So it was carried over from FY18 to FY19 and CY19. The next item for that being item number 28, and that is the transformer, the capacitors purchase in stock. That's $74,000 of the money was carried over from FY18 again. Delivered by 2019, so we got them late. And this is a common problem that we'll be facing because we have a long lead, for delivery of the items that we use for our construction. And if they deliver them late, so therefore it's going to go to the next budget, calendar budget. The next item is number 38. That's a routine construction. And the routine construction, basically, we spend a lot of money on pole hits. As you know, we've had like 15 pole hits in 2019 so far. I'm hoping that we're not going to go more, and that would be it. But these are very expensive. They cost a lot of money to, you know, replace the poles and fixing the, you know, the duct banks that they get damaged, as well as replacing the cables. We are getting reimbursed from insurance companies, but the money for that, it's going to go as other incomes that it's another bucket for that. So that's why that this number goes up, but we get some credit, and that is going to be deposited in other buckets. We also spent $141,000 on the H transformers, and we spent for the new LED floodlights and stray lights $130,000. So that's why that we went up from $1,078,000 to $1.6 million, and approximately $493,000 for underground maintenance program. These are the areas that we didn't expect them to fail, but you know, all of a sudden they became emergency because something was either hit or went, you know, bad. And we were not planned. So basically, this bucket contains everything else that was unplanned or comes out as emergency repairs or things like that. So that means that we don't have really control over that, though. So that bond is a reason for that. The next item is item number 49, and that is 475, 472 are getaway improvements. These are the ones that, you know, you guys have put so we can improve the thermal draining of the cables coming out of the station 4. As you know, the duct banks are all filled, and you know, the heat effect is reducing the ampacity of cables. So we took them to, we relocated them to the overhead from the station, directly from the station. And during the construction, we found some asbestos in the manholes. And then we had to, you know, obviously go for the asbestos abatement, which was very costly. The cost was basically $124,000 excavating cost that was higher because of the asbestos, and we had to use contractors, right? And nobody in house could, touch them. So basically, that's the reason for those variances for what was budgeted in CY19 to what was what's estimated today to December of 2019. Any question on that? If there are no questions, then I'd like to go to CY20, and I'm gonna go over the big items, big ticket items. The rest of them are pretty much routine stuff that we're asking every year. The number one big item is item number 4, the security upgrade all sites, and we're asking for $300,000. This is the comprehensive security upgrades. That includes the HD cameras. We're upgrading those cameras. This is part of the physical security that actually I went to the conference. I was at the conference in Rhode Island for NERC, NPCC, yesterday and today. And there's some serious stuff that are going on that we need to make sure we are up to date. We are fine the way we are, but the cameras, they're old. They need to be upgraded. $10,000 for the heavy-duty underground utility truck, which is carried over from FY19. So we already awarded a bid. It's being constructed, and it's going to be delivered next year. So these are the carryovers that hopefully we're going to get that, I believe, sometime in October next year. We're going to get that truck. The next item is the electric vehicle supply equipment, EVSE. And that's, we got $70,000 for 4 public EV chargers, and also $129,000 for 7 EV chargers at Analog. That construction of everything, that's going to cost approximately $10,000 for construction, $7,000 for those dual chargers, and you know, this is something that we put in budget so we can deliver that to them. So that the money's for that. The next one is number 8, the software and licensing. These basically, that's a $295,000 we're asking, the cost of transferring the servers to the cloud. And the cloud services for RMLD system, systems like, you know, UConn, that's the software for the AMI, that, you know, the AMI metering system, as well as the Great Plains and Cogsdale, the customer relations manager software, and the SharePoint. So they're all going in the cloud. You know that, you know, the cost, the operational maintenance cost for cloud-based services, they're much lower than in-house maintained servers. So actually there are great savings into that. And then there's a big, probably upfront cost to set them up, but every year after that, the cost is coming down. That's like Eaton, it's going to be costing us $20,000 as opposed to $50,000, $60,000 that if we had the server in-house, mm-hmm. and maintenance and redundancies and all of those. So overall, we're saving money, but the upfront cost for the setup, it's going to cost some money. The next item is item number 16, which is the purchase of land in Wilmington. I guess you're all aware of what's going on with that, and we're still in negotiation with the town, and I guess in the executive session, we're going to go over that. Yeah, so that's a $570,000 that was estimated, so we're negotiating with the town. Yes?
Number 11.
Yeah, number 11, right?
It's number 11.
Oh, number 11, I'm sorry. Yeah, did they say number 10?
16.
16. Oh, I'm sorry, yeah. Number 11, sorry. Yeah, the next one is number 14. Number 14 is the MDM. That's a software that is going to actually integrate the metering system. Right now, we got 2 metering systems, the AMI meter from the UConn and also for iTron. And these two now, one is multi-speak, the other one is not multi-speak, and now we have to manually write queries in order to analyze the data. We don't have data analytic capability that it's necessary for energy efficiency programs that Chuck wants to implement and be coming up with. So this MDM basically is going to give us ability to integrate and import a multiple AMI system. The ongoing validation, estimation, and editing, that's they call it VEE, of the meter interval data. This is for the data gap that between the meters for various intervals, for various reasons, if the meter is out or collector is out. So they're going to be able to use the forecasting method in order to close the gap so that data could be used for energy efficiency analytic data that they need in order to come up with more programs. The near-time handling of the alerts, the messages and exceptions, the integration of the systems within the utility on a demand and near real-time basis. It's making the billing search for accuracy, data accuracy, for billing accuracy much easier. It's making the recovery of the electrical thefts much easier, and it's going to provide better exception reports by tracking data for the billing errors. In short, it's going to give us more capability for data analytics that it's necessary for both transformer loading, load management program, as well as the efficiency program. So that's going to cost $150,000. And this could be a very expensive item, but the system that, you know, we're going to go with, we got a code that, you know, they said this is going to cost us this much. Because UConn is going in joint venture with a company that, you know, it builds the MDM. So that's how much it will be mesh network expansion. And this one, we are asking to $2,078,000 to replace 2,000 residential meters and 1,600 commercial meters that are not capable of communicating with OMS. These are the meters, ITRON meters, that they don't have the last gasp technology. And what happens right now with the OMS, in case there's an outage, you know, these meters, they're out. We don't know if they're out. Unless if they're packed or they're located or surrounded by the meters that they have the last gasp technology or capability. You know what the last gasp is, right? The last gasp, basically, when the meter is out, it's going to have just enough energy to send in a notification alert to the outage management system that, hey, I'm out. And you're not going to see me anymore until I'm back. Or whenever they're back, then it's going to say that, you know, okay, I'm back and reporting back. So basically, we need to definitely upgrade this in order to be able to, make it functional with the OMS. We are also, if you see, for the next 5 years, we are making recommendations to replace the rest of the ITRON meters. And the reason for that being because ITRON meters are basically old. They're 10 to 12 years old. The ITRON cloud solution maintenance is approximately $80,000, which is very expensive. We are right now getting that data from the cloud services. And UConn service is close to 21,000, so you could see the big difference. There's saving right there. The other reason for that, these meters are 10 to 12 years old. Technically, the meters, they're not going to last more than 15 years, you know. That's when you're going to have to start thinking about, you know, either replace them right away, or like us, we're planning to make that transition in 5 years. Each year, 5,000 meters until everything is converted to one system, which is going to be much better to handle the data. The another problem that ITRON has, it's not multi-speak. We still are going to have to do the flat file transfer, which is kind of issue, making some issues for in order to get the data out of the meters and for data analytic. That hopefully the MDM is going to be making the job much easier now to handle that in the meantime. Also, the services that ITRON is offering, those services, they're going down. You know, they're not going to support this old system. You know, the system that we have is very old. I mean, I don't believe they're going to be offering support to that in the next few years or so, because it's just old and it's not going to work with the new system, the new fixes. So basically, that's the whole story on that you see that, you know, from CY21 to CY25, we're asking $1 million each year. Rather than replace them all in 1 year, we're going to do that in 5 years. The next one you see, the item number 16, that's meters and primary metering. These two, we kept it separate because this item, the 173,000, that's the annual meters being stocked for new construction and apartments. Like, we got 200 more residential meters for new apartments in Martin's Landing, as well as the Gould Street in Reading. So we're adding 48 PTs and CTs, upgrading all of these primary meterings that we have all over the system. They're old. We're testing them. We've got a program to test them and also replace the parts as needed. That's what we are asking that money for. The next one is item number 28. We are asking $602,000 to purchase the transformers and capacitors, purchasing the response to the project. One thing I want to mention, that all the transformers that you see for all the programs, whether reliability related, new constructions, or everything is in that amount, in that figure. So everything else that you see for the reliability programs and maintenance and everything, that's not going to include the transformer. It includes everything else but the transformer. So the labor, other materials that needed to make that work, it's included on every individual project. But the transformer for those projects, this is where it's coming from. So 602. And also, it supports our age transformer replacement program as well. The next item is item number 31. That's the mentioned, I've mentioned in the past that, you know, we have a good maintenance program. We have prioritized the old areas that you know, they're underground, they're fed underground, and based on the age and, you know, the inspections that we've done. And we, every year we go and target few of those in order to do the overhaul from A to Z, upgrade everything. So those are the planned ones. Those are the ones that, you know, we planning to do. And although sometimes we're going to have to go out of sequence because something else happens that, you know, to make something else priority over the ones we planned. But three or four we try to do every year. So what we're planning to do this year, it's Deborah Drive-In ready for $165,000 and for repairing 30 manhole chimneys that basically are in tough conditions. And $14,000 for engineering, $309,000 for RMLD and contracting labors, because some of those, you know, we need to definitely use contractors. We're not equipped to do those, and especially if there are any asbestos, any kind of environmental challenges there. So we have no choice but addressing them and correcting the situation. So that's what that money is for. The next one is the age transformer replacement program. And again, the transformer for these are coming out of that, you know, that bucket. And then to replace approximately 54 pad mount transformers and 96 overhead transformers. And these are the ones that, again, have been prioritized based on the age, load, and also the physical conditions. And actually, we've been doing really good on that because for the last summer, we haven't had many transformers that, you know, they popped up. We have got a few, two, three, you know, that, you know, due to the age that they were scheduled to be replaced. But, you know, outside of that, you know, we have it pretty much under control. But we're not out of the woods yet. And I keep saying that, and I sound like a broken record. I apologize for that. But I just want the people to know that, you know, we're doing the best we can. We've got a good maintenance program. We know what we need to do. It just needs time, you know. We just need time in order to. We still got 1,400 more transformers that they're in the A category that, you know, we need to upgrade them. I mean, next 5 years we should be able to catch up to the routine. And every year we
can I ask a question? Once you catch up, how many will you have to replace each year? Once you get through those 1,400?
Okay, every year, in a good year, we can replace anywhere between 90 to 120 a year. Okay, between 90 and we're trying to bump that up to 200, you know, 20. That's what the target is.
To get through the 1,400.
To get through the 1,400. And, you know, obviously some we're going to do this year. We in CY20, we don't like about, let me see. We are doing 54 pad mount transformers and 96 overhead transformers. Most of these are overhead transformers. So for the overhead, it's not going to take much time. We can get those done faster than the underground ones. These are the ones that they, you know, take a long time in order to do that. So whatever we can get done, you know, within the budget and, you know, within the time frame that, you know, we are allocated, we're going to replace them. And in some years, if the things are not going good or we've got other priorities, so we do those and we do as much as we can.
Dave, is your question, once we get caught up, how many?
Yes, that's how it's working. Yeah, with the normal rate.
How many normal after that would be, you know, anywhere between 90 to 100.
Yeah.
110.
Yeah.
But in a good year, we have replaced even 140, you know, 150, depending on, you know, how busy we are. But that's a good question, between 90 to 100, 110.
Can you get that verbatim that you said?
Yeah. I signed it. All right. I'm sorry. Is there any other questions so far? Or okay, so we address the age transformers. The routine construction, this is my favorite, because these are the stuff that basically are unplanned. Everything else that, you know, that we plan and all of a sudden something fails that we didn't expect it, or it's going in this bucket. Like pole settings, transfer, or the underground subdivisions that the new constructions that, you know, we don't expect, and all of a sudden they show up and some people don't understand this unplanned or
this site that we're on Ash Street, and there's a lot of discussion at the town level of repurposing the site. And I know that's just kind of conceptual talk right now, but one of the goals I'd like to see us do is kind of have us tell the community, well, is that even feasible? You know, what would it cost for us to move? Is it absurd? Certainly don't have to answer it now, but the way what I'm getting at is when we're budgeting any large expenses for the site, it would be nice to know that we're envisioning how long we're going to be here. You know, if all the talk about redevelopment is never going to happen, then that's one thing. It's
solid.
Please.
Yeah. You know, one of the things that I don't even, the town hasn't even come up with a plan what to do with these with the properties.
Right.
I mean, you know, not only are you talking about this facility, but they're talking about the DPW.
Correct.
Where are they going to go?
Well, that's the question.
That's the whole thing. Everything is just a concept in the clouds at this point.
That's right. It is.
You know, so I
but
you know, I really seriously, you know, think that until we get some better plan from the town, that we should not be spending any money or anything on what we're going to do with this property.
I'm not sure what you said. You're saying we shouldn't?
We should not, because there's no plan. Show me the plan for what's going to happen down in this area.
Well, the chicken
say we should pretend like if nothing would change.
Well, until I see a plan.
Well, we have a chicken and egg situation here.
Yeah. We don't have a plan.
Yeah.
Some of the stuff that are OSHA related,
yep,
like the deck that, you know, we're fixing because it was abandoned, we have no choice. We have to spend money to make it, you
right,
know, safer.
Right.
Okay. So, but the other stuff, you know, the meeting that we went to, they said this building, I guess they could stay, right, Colleen? Am I correct? They said this building is staying. And they said that, you know, they had some conceptual designs for that station.
Yes, please.
Station one.
Yeah.
One.
I think what, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think what Dave is asking is if we have just an order of magnitude contingency plan. Meaning it's about the trucks, it's about the movement, the storage of inventory, and not down to three decimal places.
Right.
But if you were to move, or had to move, or asked to move, it would be in the order of magnitude of X dollars, between this dollar amount and that dollar amount, irrespective of the building. So we're not asking for an in-detailed report to go to the town, but I think rather a let the town know that if they want to move us out of here, it's going to cost a reasonably large amount of money to be able to do it, and something that we probably can't fund ourselves. So the town would have to, you know, be helping to fund that, which is another sort of turn of the wheel. And so that's irrespective of whether it's we would move any place else, and there are many strategic reasons why you would not want to move out of Reading, right? I mean, if there are other communities that might be more receptive us moving into. So rather than think about that, I think just order of magnitude, strategic, kind of very high level thoughts on what it would take to house all our trucks and our people and our inventory in a good facility. That's all. So correct me if I'm wrong, but
that's the gist of it. I would only add to that. What's the feasibility of it? What are the costs and the benefits of doing it? So you mentioned costs. And there are costs. Would there be benefits to us? And of course, would there be benefits to others like the town that there's a value attached to that? So I just feel like we can lead a little bit of the discussion. And it just comes up now because, and you know, it's not your problem. It's, I mean, you have to run the trains, you know, and these are consistent with that. But I would just like to see us, and it's kind of up to us as a board as well, is to, you know, be able to have these joint discussions, be able to put some inputs into the discussions. What are the costs? Is it feasible? What are the benefits? What would it take? How long do we envision being here? Thomas, chair.
Yeah, so I agree 100%. I just had a question because I may be under misunderstanding. Colleen, do we own this property here?
I'll actually let Wendy speak to that. We've been researching that. Do you want to get up and provide any input on that?
Wendy just said that she's not positive at this moment.
My reason for asking is if we do, then that's has a different focus on it.
Then, right, then we will.
So we still should be open to everything like that.
Let Wendy speak and I'll tell you what.
Phil knows. some stuff,
yeah.
All those things.
Yes. Based on the research that we've done, it appears that we own this specific building.
Okay.
It is not clear what else we own, how much land we own. It does not look like we own the substation. It does not look like we own the land that the garage is on. We may own the building, but not the land.
When you said substation, did you mean Station 1?
Yes,
okay.
Station 1. So it is very unclear. We do have documentation that we could further research, but it's preliminary at this moment.
Phil?
As to where we are.
So
Phil knows.
I led the Haven Street Task Force.
Yep.
The ad hoc committee back in the dark ages when we were on Haven Street.
By the way, the Rite Aid on Haven Street used to be RMLD headquarters.
Right.
Now it's vacant.
And so basically the research that came down at that time was that RMLD had control of all the properties. This commission would have to vote to release those to the town before the town could do anything with that. That was the research that was done at that time.
Mr. Chair, what you're saying is absolutely correct in the documents that we found. I think what's not clear is some of the deeds, the older deeds that we've looked through.
Right.
So we'd have to do a little bit more research on that. Wendy and I, we have all the documents from back when you're talking about, but the actual deeds, when you try to look at them, there's a difference between, okay, land A, and then when you look at the map, it's not labeled A. So we have to kind of correlate, and we're working on that because that question had been asked.
That would seem to be, what is it, my file cabinet? I may have that somewhere.
Mr. Chair, so
yeah.
I think both are worthwhile endeavors. That establishing that would seem to be something,
but, you know,
not urgent,
even,
but
even
important to do.
Even properties of which there's a title question or deed title, this commission would have to vote to release properties because we're using them. It's the same issue with the school committee. The property that's across from the high school that they have, their school committee would have to vote to release that property before the town could do anything with it.
Okay.
So it's the exact same issue.
So there's two things. One is the commission voting to release use of, but then there's the strict ownership question. And to John and Tom's point, let's say we owned all this stuff. That's worth a lot of money. And if there was a if and that would be an input into the process that there'd be a sale price that would fetch a lot of money, because this is prime real estate in downtown Reading. You know, it's not an industrial in the middle of nowhere. It's right near the train station. It's a great site. So if we knew the answer, then we could bring that. Okay, we could make $20 million, whatever it would be. That's okay. That's money to use to be somewhere else where maybe the land is cheaper. We could build new facilities that would last forever. I mean, instead of patching the old one kind of thing. So these are the kind of things to study, to John's point. What?
No, it would last forever.
Forever. Well, a long time.
This building, when we built it, was to last 50 years.
That's right.
We are nowhere near 50 years if you're looking for
standing. Right, but we just voted to spend $250,000 on a roof coating.
Yeah.
So we just voted to spend $250,000 on a roof coating. So these are the kind of things where...
But I mean, I don't think it needs to be point I'm trying to get. It doesn't need to be a big detailed study.
No.
I mean, that's.
We just need more information out there.
I don't want to see, you know.
Mr. Chair, can I?
Please.
Yeah.
We're spending, instead of purchasing a rubber roof to replace that's over $500,000, and we've talked about this, we are spending money to seal it because every office has buckets collecting water.
Right, we're not relitigating the roof. I'm just saying. There's a cost associated with staying. Go ahead, finish, please.
And so I'm just saying is we've been making prudent decisions to keep this as an asset because there's no indication that it's going to be torn down and it remains an asset. So for the deck, for example, is condemned, we're just replacing it with some concrete and steel railings to keep it as an asset.
Got it.
Okay, so if we were to sell it one day, that it would still be in great shape and at least not leaking and the roof caving in. So we are being very cautious with what we're replacing and fixing in this building. You know, paint, some carpet to keep people from tripping, repairing the roof, very minimal. But we, as Hamid said, though, we have some pretty major OSHA issues over in operations that we're going to need to address.
Right.
And we're going to have to go back to a facilities site plan review that, if you remember on the budget, we've delayed that for 4 years.
Yep.
And we're going to have to make a decision. We're either going to fix it or we're not. not going to fix it, but that we're not going to be able to keep employees in there if we continue in this direction without any repairs. And we have rental tenants in there as well, of the credit union.
I think we've, let's move on.
Good, thanks.
But we need some of these answers.
Motion. Okay, we move that the RMLD Board of Commissioners approve the calendar year 2020 capital budget in the amount of $11,513,482 as presented on the recommendation of the general manager.
Second.
Just want to add this before.
Please, Phil.
I actually attended the CAB meeting when they both this was presented that night. It was my turn. And they did vote 3-0 to recommend the budget, too. I just want to bring that point up.
Okay.
The CAB.
Okay, we have a motion and we have a second.
Second.
Well, I think we do have that already, and all in favor of the motion and the second.
Yep.
Okay. Thank you, Hamid.
Thank you.
5-0.
I got some bids.
Oh, good.
Well, no, let's do the operating, but not do the operating.
I think we got another budget.
Let's do the operating.
Unless we want to just not have that budget.
Okay, good evening. I'm here to present, the calendar year 2020 operating budget. And if you would turn to page 93, you could follow along with the spreadsheet that everybody is pretty familiar with. It's the actual and projected fixed and semi-variable costs. Everybody all set?
Continue.
Okay. So the first, it's on your iPads. You got it.
It should be reflected in the minutes if you drop your tape.
Sorry, I got it right there.
The first section, the top section, is what we typically call fixed costs. And what we mean, just to clarify, fixed costs. These are basically contracts that are already locked in. So if you're looking at your purchase power, which is 70.31%. Of the total fixed costs, there's nothing we can do about that at this time. The contracts are already locked in, and those are the costs associated with the contracts. I would like to say that there's a decrease of $2.2 million in power supply as compared to calendar year 19. And moving along, your depreciation expense, which is also based on a previous year gross plant amount, $4.7 million, which is 5.15% of the budget. The voluntary payment to the town of Reading at $2.4 million is 2.7% of the budget. The town payments, which is the 2% of net plant, $1.6 million or 1.76% of the budget. And loss on disposal of assets, we always have that. There's it's very minimal at $100,000. The second part of this spreadsheet is the semi-variable cost. So if you look, so I changed it up a little bit this year so it would be a little clearer for you. When I mentioned the labor and the overtime, I actually gave you the total labor and then I subtracted the capital so it's clear what the total is versus just seeing the operating portion.
What page are you on?
93.
Thank you.
But it's being displayed up here in the...
Okay.
Yeah.
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 E-A-U-T.
Good? Yes? Okay. So total labor of $8.7 million with capital portion of almost $2 million. The total labor is 8.29% of the budget. Again, it's all locked in labor contracts. Overtime at $1 million. Well, $1,051,000 decrease from calendar year 19, and a capital portion of $176,000, less than 1% of the budget. Then, if you look at employee benefits and pension, that's all. That's pension, OPEB. That's your insurance, health insurance costs, $4.4 million, and we do take the portion of the loaded rate for the capital portion of the labor of the RMLD employees, that's $747,000. The total employee benefits is 3.99% of the budget. And then if you look at other operating and maintenance expenses, it's gone down from $2.2 million to $1.6 million, 1.8% of the budget, total budget. Then you have your conservation expenses at about $958,000, or 1% of the budget. Your tree trimming costs are pretty much staying the same. We were very successful with that budget, about $899,000, less than 1% of the budget. Then you have your outside contract services, $361,000. Those are your mostly engineering services, professionals that come in and give us some studies or whatnot. That's about 0.39% of the budget. Your legal expenses going down because we're no longer in a negotiating year, $498,000, 0.5% of the budget. Property insurance, $437,000. Software and hardware maintenance, $394,000. That is increasing slightly because the cost of automation continues to go up with maintenance of software products. And your contracts, $394,000. Your transformers or your hazardous material, about $210,000 in case there's a spill. Training and tuition, $266,000. Vehicle expense, $333,000. And $225,000 of that goes to the capital projects. Your rent expense is $212,000. And bad debt, we do reserve $105,000, even though we never really meet that target, thankfully. Injuries and damage insurance, $70,000, and $26,000 of that it goes to capital. And then your RMLD and cabs, $30,000, and office supplies at $20,000. So overall, the decrease in the budget is about 1.8%, mainly to power supply, just so you know that. And I did mention $2.2 million of decrease in power supply. So we are not asking for a rate increase this year at this current time, pending anything earth-shattering that we're not aware of at this time. I did include a six-year projection. Of course, that's a moving target. We do the best we can, you know, with what we know at the time, and it does often change, but it's a good look at where we are and where we're going. So any questions?
Yeah, I think we just need to call out the power supply savings and, like, highlight that achievement and just maybe hear a little bit more about how it's a great thing, just how that was achieved. And
do you want to talk to it at all, Chuck?
Or just, you know, just for a minute, just to kind of highlight the achievement and the success of the department in this area. Or
Yeah, because, I mean, I think at the end of the day it's productivity, right? You look at the increase.
Yeah.
I will point out this occurred on my watch, so I'm taking full credit and responsibility.
We were afraid you were going to say that.
I have watched recent presidential occupants of the office take full blame, and then I'm getting out of here before anything falls apart. What's happened over time is that the power supply portfolio is made up of a number of contracts of various durations. As those contracts expire, they are being replaced. Since those contracts were initially entered into, the price in the market has dropped a little bit. So we're fortunate to be in a period of low and stable costs. If you recall from the presentations that I've made over the last year, I just come in every month and say, yeah, same story. Every month the costs are stable and low, and we're expecting that that will continue. What we see over the next couple of years, which is part of the six-year forecast right now, is that a significant portion of our portfolio is expiring. And in about 3 years, we're going to be looking at 70% of our portfolio open. So we have a lot of flexibility in terms of what we look at. There are a number of opportunities that are presenting themselves now. These opportunities will allow us to expand the non-carbon component of our portfolio. So we can improve our position here in Massachusetts against what we hope will be the new standard coming out of the legislature. One of the reasons that that remains open, I don't like having a 1 year or less open piece in the portfolio, but we don't have direction from the legislature at this point as to what our responsibilities, obligations, and targets will be. So we're in a bit of a fluid period.
When is
right
that
now.
Expected to get resolved, the MEAB legislation or others?
I honestly don't know. We're hopeful that in this next session of the legislature that it will be addressed. We have expressed our concerns over not addressing it and the impacts on us. And we continue to carry that message to the legislature. So,
please.
I've asked Chuck if perhaps he can do a presentation in December, if we're going to meet, or January, on that exact topic. Because in the interim, we are at least, as a minimum, making the Clean Energy Standards Act, which is excellent, so we can go over that and show you where we are. And I think that would lead into input for where you would want the policy to go on renewables. Okay? So if we want to do that presentation in December, we can plan it for that, and then maybe in January do an EV workshop.
That sounds good to me.
Yeah. Shifting of the rate, please.
One of the things that is sort of an ancillary effect as our power costs go down, power costs are a pass-through, and so therefore we may see a decline in retail rates, but there is no impact on our operating portion of the budget for that. It's merely reflecting the pass-through impacts of the power supply portfolio.
Wendy made a statement that we are not recommending any rate adjustments next year, correct?
Correct.
But we have some phasing in of readjustments of residentials that I would like Chuck to speak to, so that if anyone got a little bit of an adjustment in their bill, they'd be like, okay, Reading said they weren't increasing the rate. This is a multi-phased shifting that residentials were had gone 11% and we were migrating that back to zero.
So it's already is pre-announced.
It's already pre-announced, but I just, instead of saying absolutely none, there is no new, but instead of doing the residential in 1 year, we decided to phase it in over 3 years.
So what Colleen is referring to is the overall revenue requirement, which we are not expecting to increase, versus the allocation of responsibility for costs to our different classes, residential, non-residential. And back in 2017, which was the last cost of service study, there was a determination that there needed to be a realignment of some of the costs. We are also, in 2020, doing an update to that cost of service to determine whether we're still in line with that and whether we need to adjust the adjustments, if you will. So, but there may be some shifts among the classes as to where the revenue responsibilities lie with it, without impacting the overall revenues.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Can we do the motion?
Let's do it.
Let's see. Move that the RMLD Board of Commissioners approve the calendar year 2020 operating budget with a net income of $4,479,987 as presented on the recommendation of the General Manager.
Second.
Just again to add, Mr. Chair, that the CAB meeting on that night, and they did vote to recommend this 3-0.
Okay, thank you, Phil. Okay. We have a motion and a second.
I did.
Yep. Yep.
All
yep.
in favor? All against?
Nope.
5-0. Thank you very much, Wendy.
Thank you, Wendy.
Okay, thank you. And now we get to the recommendations of the General Manager Committee, which we did our performance evaluation on
right.
the 7th of November, which is for the July
2018 to July 2019.
So it's the year ending June 30th of this, so like 5 months ago, is what we're talking about.
Under the old fiscal year.
Under the old fiscal year, yep. And I thought we'd just maybe, well, we could move to the action that was recommended by that, but perhaps beforehand, you know, Dave Hennessy had suggested, you know, we have this existing process that's been around a while, and he had some suggestions on how we might tweak it. Dave and Tom, both being HR professionals, and we have one in the back of the room as well, who's
surrounded.
Dave, do you want to talk
sure.
a little bit about what the old was and what you're suggesting?
Yes, we were doing it on an annual basis with a quantitative approach, rating on a 100-point scale. And the trends in HR have really shifted. And really, it's kind of unfair to give performance evaluations on something that might have happened 10, 12 months ago. It's really not fair or effective, really. So the trends have gone with more frequent feedback and also less quantitative, to go with more qualitative, have a discussion about performance more frequently during the year. So the recommendation is to shift this completely and to go with, I'll just read the process that I've outlined here, we can discuss a little bit, to go with a new process that replaces the old numerical process and the old salary increase calculation. However, performance goals on the current form will be retained as part of the process. So the performance goals are good. So we're just going to remove the numbers. I'm recommending that we remove the numbers. The other thing is about when you give a number to somebody, when you're doing performance reviews, it just becomes about the number, and conversations get stifled. People are finding that it's not very effective. The board shall have qualitative performance guidance discussions, this is the second point, with the GM and executive sessions after the board meetings on April, July, October, and January of each year. So there'll be quarterly feedback sessions and guidance. Number three, the January performance discussion shall be for the fourth quarter of the prior year and also a roll-up summary of all the other three quarterly reviews. So kind of roll it all up to one feedback session. No surprises, just discussions and guidance. Number four, the quantitative numerical ratings, as I mentioned, are eliminated, given that they are considered outmoded in the HR profession. However, the areas outlined in the old annual evaluation shall remain as a guide, plus key annual priorities put forth by the commissioners in consultation with the GM each December. So this would be a few priorities that we, in discussion with the general manager, think, in addition to the major goals that we already have each year, things of what we want to focus on in that coming year. And those could be tweaked in our executive session summaries as conditions change. There might be things that come up that, you know, something happens and we might need to shift those. Then fifth, to de-link the annual compensation discussion with these performance guidance conversations. And just do that at a separate time, maybe do it in December. So the annual compensation discussion and decision shall be based on four factors. Comparison to statewide GM salary benchmarks to the munis, the financial health of RMLD, the results of the GM performance evaluation process, as we described, so that's still a factor, and then other economic factors determined by the board. So that's the proposal, and I'd love to hear what Tom O'Rourke thinks about this first, since you've been an executive in HR for tens of years.
Just one item, Mr. Chair. I would instruct that the secretary that this sheet be included as part of the minutes.
Yep.
Thank you.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so thank you, Dave. So I support Dave's recommendation. There's used to be a saying in HR, which is probably still true in a lot of companies, that was that unique human encounter where the manager gets no sleep the night before and the employee gets no sleep the night after. So, and what I'm really saying and what David said, so if you talk to someone, unfortunately a lot of companies, that annual review is the only conversation. So what we're really saying is we're trying to move away from once a year the employee gets sat down, so to speak, and is told what they didn't do. And, of course, that's the bad news. But the real bad news is there's no time to do anything about it because the year's already been completed. So, you know, if you want to go back, and, you know, all of this is rooted in the workplace changes. Years ago, people got paid by producing stuff, right? So many widgets. And it was very easy to measure production, very easy to quantify whether they did or didn't do it. They did 20 of these in a day or 50 or whatever. But today's world is much more complex. There's a lot more focus on innovation, teamwork, critical thinking, strategic thinking. So we want to really say go from once a year to a multiple, four-time a year kind of thing. And, of course, really the point is managers should be talking to their employees, you know, at the company level, you know, almost daily, right, in terms of feedback and so forth. So the other thing is, it's as Dave said, this current process is rear view. We go to look at everything that was done in the past. We really want to be forward thinking. And as Dave said, it doesn't make sense to give constructive feedback to someone on an issue that happened 8 months ago. You know, that's unfair, really. So I think it also focuses, again, not on the ratings, and I think we found ourselves, particularly in recent years, focusing on numbers that rather than on capabilities, on results, on development, and that sort of thing. And lastly, I would say, you know, there's no question in all my experiences, and I'm sure Janice had the same experience. I'm sure Dave, in your involvement with all the HR practitioners, it tends to be an adversarial relationship. You know, the manager has the, you know, it's what is written, so there's no opportunity to influence. And instead of being a collaborative process, it should be all about improvement and development. So I think Dave is, we're catching up, so to speak, with the best practices here.
So I agree. I think it's interesting and innovative of what you speak in terms of changing the process. I think we do need to be cognizant, though, of that that we have a contract with the general manager, and we need to make sure that it fits within the context of that contract. So that's just an item that we need to be very careful about.
Yeah, and I think at the end, it's at least from my perspective, it's the contract should reflect what the process is. I think the end result will be for all parties a lot better because I think the feedback process will be more meaningful, and we'll do a better job at it as well.
Does our general manager have any comment on?
So maybe.
I do have one. So, and you're right, the contract is certain dates and we're shifting. You want to I understand you would like to shift it to January. Calendar year review.
Right.
So this is ending this past July, and then we still have a review period that I'm assuming will be consistent with what we started with in July,
right,
until the end of the year. Okay? So
like this would start fresh for next year, for like January 1st would start this. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, Dave and I think what I would envision, Dave's, you may have a same or a different perspective. We have because we've changed our fiscal year, this review tonight is really encompassing the calendar, the fiscal year that ended June 30th.
Right.
So what's unaccounted for now that we're on a calendar fiscal process is the 6 months remaining in this year. So my thought would be whether or not we adopt this or not, we need to provide performance feedback and a salary evaluation for that six-month period, and that would require some proration because it's obviously not a full year, but that's done normally in the process. And then going forward, if we adopt this process in April, we'd have a shorter, and again, the idea of these is not to duplicate things 40 times, right? So it's not an hour and a half. That's necessary session is really looking at smaller chunks of performance time and focusing on that period of time and also looking forward.
In terms of implementing something, can we say that at the December, not the December 2 meeting, but the next one, we could have any feedback into this draft and that we could have an action item for the late December meeting? Is there any reason not to do that?
I just have a question. I mean, is the subcommittee dissolved?
It will be dissolved. And our next, one of our motions here is to dissolve it. So
right,
this
so
is
we
a...
We have to change my contract. We have to have that reviewed. So are we doing all that in an open session between now and
whatever
December?
Whatever tweaks we would have
we
to make.
An executive session.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, whether we do, which I think we're proposing not to do nothing, but even if we weren't discussing a process change, we still need as a board to do something in January to manage that 6 months.
Right, that 6 month period.
Yeah.
And so you stated it exactly correctly. Nothing will change in terms of the evaluation process in that 6 month period. We use the same forms, the same quantitative.
But this would start in 2020.
Yes,
yeah.
This new would start in 2020.
Right.
And but approving it prior to that to start in 2020 is fine. Comments back from all of us.
Yes.
So the question is, would we have to be rewriting your contract? I'm trying to.
I would have to. How would it affect the contract? I guess we have to look at it.
I think this reference to. I don't think it.
This reference
I think it can be done with. Sorry.
I think there's a reference to some mutually agreed process, right?
Yeah.
That's what we're talking about.
Yeah.
We have to agree on this process.
I have to go back and reread it. It's been a long
time.
We're getting in the weeds here, though.
Yeah, my gut feel is it could be done if assuming everything was agreed to in the process. I think the contract would probably, on something like this, have some minimal comments because you don't want to get into specific details in the initial contract as it as well. But I would say that's something we should just
I just want to say that, you know, I'm not an HR person. I'm a bean counter. And I do support this. I've struggled with the numerical rating for years. Because I can't tell you what the difference between a 6 and a 7 is.
Yeah, right.
You know?
It's one, but I mean, I know. but I mean,
he's a calculator.
I know. I take your point, Phil. I feel the same way. People approach it differently. What do the numbers really mean? So, I like this. I love the spirit of this. I just wanted, from a process point of view, how do we get something like this implemented?
Mm-hmm.
And if we can do so in the late December meeting, following feedback and Colleen's input, do whatever the tweaks are that we have to do. I think this agreement.
Move to the motion.
Yeah, I just may add just one other point. I don't have a specific recommendation, but as we think through this, moving away from numerics, we need to be able to at least without writing 20 paragraphs, we need the ability as a board to be able to describe goodness and, you know, not goodness.
Right.
So whether that comes down to, you know, descriptors, or we could think a little bit about how we want to do that. I don't think that'll be a big deal, but just... going from, you know, a number to a
got it
to words. Yeah.
And I'm just gonna skip B, but I wanted to say I would like us to set to what Dave just mentioned is that the commission has a short list of 3 or 4 priorities and goals that we also articulate those in December of each year, and we could do that in the late December meeting. I have a couple that I've put on the table that, you know, we don't need to get into now. We're in the weeds. You guys should all also offer up maybe have a list of a maximum of 5. My top one is that we do get our heads around the site here and be able to have a feasibility of
you're getting into the weeds.
I'm in the weeds. Okay,
so
we'll have that discussion at the next meeting.
Yes.
And so do the motion D, John, and then let's get back to disband. We'll disband the committee.
Move that the board approve the general manager
committee's
recommendation that effective July 1st, 2019, Ms. O'Brien receive a salary increase of 4% in addition to a $4,000 bonus paid out as Ms. O'Brien chooses as ICMA, cash, or a combination of the two.
You have a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion before we vote?
Just a comment, and maybe you plan to do it afterwards, Mr. Chair. So I think it's appropriate and typical this time to whether the subcommittee does it just to characterize the performance because we're recommending.
Yeah, briefly, yeah. Yeah, sure. Would you like to do that, Tom?
I can certainly.
Sure.
So I think we all, as is the process, we all provided individual evaluations, and I think the bottom line is, as a committee, good job this past year in all the key performance areas, and she's basically responded to all the actions in the studies. We had both the human capital study as well as the study on the reliability of the RMLD, and we had zero findings in the audit again this year. So from an overall point of view, I think it's the performance that the board is pleased with, and I think it's reflected in the recommendation.
Agreed, and I would add to that the launching of the battery program.
Yeah, I was just going to mention that too.
Right. The whole engineering staff and Colleen, you know, thank you for that achievement. That's a great one for the RMLD and statewide kind of benchmark.
Yeah.
So I think that was some of our thought behind the bonus too.
The only thing that I'll add is that I think she's done an outstanding job of hiring people for this department.
Yes,
yes,
I agree.
Mm-hmm. We discussed that as well.
Yes.
Including the HR director.
That's right. There's a couple of people in this
room. A couple of people in this room.
Yes.
Yeah.
So with that, we've had a motion and a second. Right?
Yes, we would vote.
I think we should. All in favor? Okay. All opposed? None. So that's 5-0. Thank you, Colleen, very much.
Thank you, Colleen.
Now the
excuse me, Dave, I also have to say, I think we singled out Jana, but I think we've heard in the presentations, you know, we have everybody in this room that's on the staff has done an excellent job.
Excellent.
And it's reflected in the of the utility. So thank you all.
Second.
And how do we, Phil, do you want to word a motion? The general manager committee recommended that it disband itself or abolish itself. Can you render that into a motion?
Okay. I'll recommend that move that the Board of Commissioners
accept the recommendation of the...
accept the recommendation of the General Manager Subcommittee to disband that committee from this date forward.
Okay.
Second.
Okay. All in favor? Okay, we have 5-0, and we have disbanded the General Manager Committee, so we will just take care of this from now on. Okay.
Yeah, I just saying out loud that we're taking care of it as a whole board. Instead of
opposed to
the three of us, right?
Yeah, that's
right. I guess it's assumed.
Which is no reflection of
what
the
thank you.
Subcommittee did.
Exactly.
I'm saying that out loud for the minutes.
Okay, thank you very much.
Great subcommittee. I thought we were great.
Thank you, Colleen, and thank you, everybody. So now we're on to procurement items, right? Do you want to start, or do you want Phil to do the motion and you explain?
All right, I'll move the proposal IFP 2019-24 for three-phase pad-mounted transformers be awarded to Wesco Distribution Inc. for $174,625 pursuant to Mass General Laws Chapter 164, Section 56D, on the recommendation of General Manager.
Second.
Hamid?
Yes, these are the transformers for age transformers replacement program, as well as some of the projects that, you know, we need to add transformers, which is going to add to the plant value. We send a bid to 12 bidders, actually, 12 vendors, and only one came out as lowest responsive bidder. The others, actually, they did not bid it right, because we asked for a radial-type transformer, and then what they did, they gave us the looped transformer, which that was not in the bid. They didn't read the bid right, or they did, and they didn't have it in stock, and then they rather to give us the looped one, which that was not part of the bid. So that's why you see zero for other bidders, and only the only company that responsively bid to what we asked for was Wesco for $174,625 for these transformers.
Just as an aside on the machines, it's actually a separate tab that's on here. It's not part. Well, you have the budget in front of you, right? So
yep.
It's a separate thing. So you need to kind of close out the budget and go to the other one where the backup is.
So the backup information is on page 2, and this is basically the remainder of what was left in the budget for CY19. So
got a motion and a second.
Okay.
All in favor? All opposed? Motion carries 5-0.
Move that IFP 2019-26 for construction and installation of new standby generator with ATS be awarded to Sparks Company, Inc. for $130,687 pursuant to Mass General Laws Chapter 49/ Chapter 30, Section 39M, as the lowest responsible and eligible bidder on the recommendation of General Manager.
Second.
Okay, this is basically the civil construction that we need for putting that generator on the pad and some rewiring, repiping, as well as installing the automatic transfer switch. That's what ATS stands for, automatic transfer switch. So we sent a bid to 19 bidders, and only three responded without taking any exceptions. That was McDonald Electric, Sparks Company, and Your Electrical Solutions. So the lowest responsive bidder was Sparks Company at the price of $130,687.
Any questions or discussion?
Is this something we have now? Is this something in place for the current year? Let me rephrase it. Is this a new item that we've never had before?
That's right. Because, you know, the generator failed and,
yep.
you know, we didn't have it in the
yep.
budget.
Yep.
So this is what part of that $185,000 that you saw that we said that, you know, we spent even over the budget for that reason. This is basically the reason.
I love the name of the company, Sparks.
Sparks.
California would like
yeah.
it.
We hope not.
Because there is labor involved, so it's Chapter 39M GL clause. So.
Okay. Any questions?
No.
We've had a motion and a second.
Right? We already had that, yep.
Okay. All in favor? Okay. All opposed? Motion carries 5-0.
Thank you so much. I appreciate
thank
it.
Thank you, Hamid.
Okay. Thanks, Hamid.
Okay, we've already confirmed that we're having the meeting on the 2nd at 6:30. That is, just make sure you know that.
Up to 6:30.
Study will get posted, marked draft on the website, and then we're gonna have another meeting on Thursday, the 19th.
Yep. Mr. Chair.
Yep.
On the, it's still unclear if I will have to, but I mentioned an early communication to Tracy that I may have to dial in that one. It's just gonna depend. So.
We're all very disappointed to hear that, Tom.
Sorry.
Next time, maybe you could try to. No, I'm just kidding.
And the CAB meeting will be held before this meeting, 6:30.
I got a couple things under the
this room.
General discussion.
Okay.
On the 19th.
Yes, Chair from Kathleen. Right now, the 12th and the 19th was put up. So the numbers to see which one was better.
Sorry,
Mr. Chair.
Yeah. Early this week, an email went out to see if the 12th.
We have
the December 19th. Better for both.
Oh, okay.
And I'm just waiting to.
As long as I know where it is, that's fine.
I haven't heard back yet.
You know, I'm realizing I don't think I can be there on the 19th.
That's Mr. Chair. I was going to say the same thing. That week is bad for me, actually, so I don't know that I'll be do any
day
that week.
Yeah, we may not.
Maybe just.
What are our options? Can we do it earlier?
Earlier, maybe? Could we just have the December 2nd meeting be a little longer and just do it all and then do it all?
Well, we want to try to get this evaluation thing done, too. I don't think we're going to have that done in a week.
Yeah.
Let's try to find a different day. I know I got to be out of town.
Maybe the week before.
You know,
that
what about
be 2 weeks
Monday,
in a row,
the,
right?
Monday, the whatever? The
2 weeks. Mondays in a row?
Well, it would be 2 weeks later, so it would be the 16th.
If I may, this one, Tracy, maybe if you wouldn't mind, this may require Tracy getting
offline.
Her schedule.
Yeah, because there's a lot going on at the end of December.
I mean, we'll all go home and find out. We're
to send an email around.
Okay.
Dates.
Okay.
Yep.
All right.
Go ahead. Is there a window when we should have, because it could be too early, in which case things won't be ready, like. It just as a thought, if we don't have enough to have a normal meeting like we do every month, maybe it's a focused meeting on the performance review piece that we could also be more flexible with in terms of AM or PM.
yeah, I'm fine with doing something like that.
That helps because it is going to be a...
That week is a tough week, though, that week of the teens for me.
The holidays, yeah.
I don't know if I can do any day that week. So.
Okay. All right, we'll work it out offline then.
Yes.
All right, I'll yield back the rest of my time.
Phil had a couple items he wanted to bring up.
I realized probably during the meeting that since I brought up the issue of the minutes, maybe I should take care of the minutes for this meeting. I don't want to disappoint Tom, but I think I will.
As long as it doesn't happen again.
So, since I brought the issue. The other issue that I came across, I heard on NPR radio this morning that the town of Brookline voted a bylaw in that the no fossil fuels on all new buildings.
Mm-hmm. I heard that.
Yeah, with the idea that it would eliminate gas, you know, pipelines and infrastructure, with the idea that it would push everything toward electricity.
And no more oil, right? No more oil heating, so it would increase the electric.
There's a forum, that organization, is it CAN or which one is it?
I don't know, but
you know what it is, David.
It's voted in by town, but it's a bylaw voted in by Brookline Town Meeting last night.
Yeah. I know, I saw it. There's an email on it today.
Come on up to the mic, let's talk about it.
I was just going to say, it sounds similar to California's
Berkeley, yeah.
Yep.
So
that's a pretty interesting approach.
Yep. Just wanted to bring that up.
Okay. Thank you, Phil.
Yep.
Sure. I have a, it's right here. It's actually having a webinar December 4th. About Brookline's gas ban. The Brookline warrant article is really important because climate change is defining the issues of our time. Buildings are more than 50%. So you get an explanation why. But they're having a December 4th a webinar on it for those who are.
Okay. And the last item was AP payroll questions. And I did see that there was a question asked, right? That was in the board book. So I didn't see the answer come back to the board. Is that, don't we have a new thing where we're bringing answers back to the board in the meeting?
I got an email to us.
Well, we haven't seen it in email or in the... Right. Correct. We do it in the meeting is the new thing, right?
I'm not sure. Let's discuss that in executive session.
Colleen, didn't we have a whole thing about this where we're doing this? Instead of bringing in an email, we bring it in the board book and at the public meeting?
It's in the board book.
It's not that the question and the answer is not in the board book.
Yes, it is. You're looking at the wrong one.
Okay, show me.
I'll show you where it is.
I hope I stand corrected here. I didn't see it. Says there was a question on October 28th. There was a commissioner question regarding an employee's overtime pay, but the question isn't in here and the answer isn't in here. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. That's the reason it's
right.
You're right.
Okay, so we have to figure out a policy on this because we went through this last month. But okay, all right, let's adjourn.
Okay.
Yeah, go ahead.
Move that the Board of Commissioners go into executive session to discuss confidential, competitively sensitive, and proprietary information in relation to making, selling, or distributing electric power and energy, consider complaints brought against a public officer, employee, staff member, or individual, discuss personal real estate, and discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining, return to regular session for the sole purpose of adjournment.
Okay. Second. Okay. All in favor?
Mr. Seymour.
Aye. Mr. Seymour. Aye. Okay. Thank you, everybody.